And NLP is really something universal for life in general. So it's not only for language learning. It's not only for success or lifestyle or business. It's for anything. You just really make it work around your needs and around your life. So hello, everyone. As you might know, I am Elena, and I am an NLP language coach. For those of you who are not familiar with NLP, it's Neurolinguistic Programming, and it's a powerful set of tools and techniques to rewire your brain and behaviors. And I adapted it in education and learning and teaching, and it's amazing to see how powerful it is in students, like when they struggle with something or when they've got mindset blocks or when they have no clarity and so on. It's amazing to see how they can accelerate when I give them the right tools. So I love it. And you are, Adan, you also are a language coach, and you're also familiar with NLP. So tell us a little bit more about
NLP. NLP changed my life, you know. In the university, I studied computer programming, and we learn how to program computers, you know, code. But our brain, it can be used as a metaphor. You can use computers as a metaphor for your brain. You can reprogram your thoughts, your emotions to empower you to be able to do what you want in life, to feel how you want on a consistent basis.
Yeah.
So I'm 37 now, but I started that journey when I was about 21, and it just upgraded my brain, my emotions, everything. Yeah. That's what NLP is.
Yeah, and NLP is really something universal for life in general. So it's not only for language learning. It's not only for success or lifestyle or business. It's for anything. You just really make it work around your needs and around your life and stuff. So would you like to give us a little bit of introduction? Who you are, where you're from, what you do?
All right. So my name is adansensei, Adan Pardo. I was born in Mexico, Tijuana, Mexico, in the north part of Mexico. I am currently living in the United States, in San Diego, which is right next to my hometown in Mexico. So I'm at the border between the U.S. and Mexico, and I go back and forth as I please. So right now, I'm a language coach-life coach because I'm passionate about languages, but I also am passionate about helping people become the best versions of themselves, you know? We all have, like I said, we all have viruses, mind viruses, things from our past experiences that unconsciously we don't know that we let them control us. But once you know how to reprogram your brain, like you said, and reprogram and feed it amazing things, it's like putting on new glasses that let you see amazing possibilities.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. Yes. And I mean, I feel like most of language coaches are a little bit life coaches as well, you know, because like when you guide people through their blocks or challenges and stuff, you really need to understand the root of the problem. So there is always some life coaching around that
as
well.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've got someone from Brazil. Hello.
So yeah, otaku, Saimo-chan. He's a really good friend of mine.
International Instagram live today. So shall we talk about how languages enriched our lives? So I can
absolutely
start with this super fresh example. I shared it on my stories the other day.
Mm-hmm.
So I take tango classes when I can.
Oh.
And yes, and I've got a little bit of background in dancing. So, and this is something that really lights me up. I just love it and stuff. And in the last month or so, there's this new guy teaching tango, and he is from Argentina, and he speaks a little English. So he holds classes in Spanish, and and his partner, she's from Portugal. His partner translated into English. Okay. So, and then, so it's already like two languages, right? And I do speak, I mean, I lost it a little bit. My passive knowledge of Spanish is still like super high, but like when I want to speak Spanish, it's a little bit challenging. But I feel like when I will go to South America at some point, I will pick it back up easily. Anyway,
you will.
So two languages. And then in the last class I went to, it was on Saturday, and then there were like two Russian ladies, and then there were like two Italian guys, a couple. And I was like, oh, that's amazing. You know, like it's not only the tango class. It's like an amazing possibility for me to practice all the languages, you know? And I just feel like every time I have the opportunity to speak with someone in their language, there's a different level of connection, you know? Like, because when someone speaks a language that is not their native language, there's always like a little, it does feel like a barrier. I don't know, like something like
an extra cushion that's in between. Yeah.
But when you speak their native language, people just tend to open up easily. And I just find it easier to connect with people.
And absolutely.
Yeah. People are more like open-minded and keen to connect with you and talk with you and stuff. So that's my first point on how languages enrich my life. What about you?
Wow. I mean, yeah, that's amazing. I could pick too many things to talk about from that. But from my perspective, languages, obviously, first of all, brain-wise, I mean, it's incredibly fun mental fitness if you perceive it that way, right? You're making constant connections. It's an infinite world you get into. There's a ton of languages, thousands of languages in the world, and each of them help you make new connections. So brain fitness wise, it's like the ultimate Rubik cube. And every time you make new connections with new cultures, you make new distinctions about who you are. You understand people more at a deep root level, and you get access to tons of amazing food, tons of amazing people, you know, tons of amazing experiences. So when we're stuck in one little bubble, we get into habitual patterns easily, you know. But when you step out, even going to a new city, even if you go to somewhere that's different from your current environment, your brain loves novelty. So when you go to a new country, it's like you're back to being a baby again, because babies are always like, everything's so new to them that they're examining their environment all the time, and their brain is like When you leave that environment that you've built routines and habits, it's like you come back alive. It's like we stop being zombies doing our daily routine stuff. And it's like, whoa, I stepped out of the matrix and now I can live again. You know, that's how it feels for me.
It does make you feel alive. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And I mean, I can totally, and that's interesting actually, because I'm reading this book on neuroscience, and something I recently read in this book is actually that our brain is designed to keep learning stuff. And as you said, you know, if you want to be still smart and have a good memory and stuff when you're 80, how do you get that? By learning new things and getting new information. And for new information, it's not scrolling Instagram, it's not reading newspaper or like useless stuff. Learning new challenging skills. And one of them is learning a language, guys. So it's scientifically proven that actually learning a language is challenging enough to help your brain remain smart, strong, fit, and so on.
Yeah, it's fitness for the brain, you know, use it or lose it, build some mental muscles, new mental connections, strengthen the one you already have, go out of your comfort zone and just live again. It's like being born again for me every time I go into a new culture, in a new world.
And we've got a comment which is super, super powerful. Indigenous people open up when you at least try to use their language and engage with their culture. That was my second point, actually. The second point is that it's not only about speaking someone's language, it's about knowing about their culture as well, having a little bit of understanding of what their culture is made of, what is their mentality, what are some of their traditions, you know? Because like if you keep this in mind, if you know some of these things, you will connect even on a deeper level. So it's not only the language, but it's the culture as well that enriches your life as well, you know?
What Absolutely. Do you think? Yeah, that's a key point that I see it happening all the time right here. Like right now I'm in San Diego. So there's a rich community of people from all over the world here. You know, you got Chinese, you got Taiwanese, Filipinos, you got people from Brazil, you got Japanese. It's like a mixed pot. Yeah. I mean, the US is like that. So yeah. Before I could speak languages, I would just, let's say I go into a Chinese food restaurant and the person's there in their own world. They're working, they're really hard. Sometimes you get really great service. Sometimes you get just, it seems like a cranky person. You know, they're just in their own thing because they're trying to like work as fast as possible. The moment you start speaking their language, whoa, what's going on here? You know, it's like you knock them out of their pattern of being in their hypnosis of work. And it's like, this is new. This is rare. Whoa, who are you? I want to get to know you.
Definitely. Yeah. But like when did you start learning languages actually?
For me, since I grew up here in the border, when I was growing up, growing up with Spanish, but I had some family members that spoke English. And also the only access to quality entertaining TV that I could get was American TV. It was either American fun TV or soap operas in Spanish, you know? Mm-hmm. So I didn't want to watch Maria go with Pedro and see how their love affair bloomed or anything. I wanted to watch The Simpsons. I wanted to watch, you know, cartoons, fun movies, Star Wars. Even though I couldn't understand it all, I was immersing myself in the movies. And I sort of picked up English naturally. Basically, that was my second language. My first language was Spanish. But when I started with Japanese, that's where I really had to learn the meta, learn how to learn Japanese. That's where I really had to put my effort in it. But it was sort of easy because I became addicted to the culture and I was always studying it, always immersing in it. And I got to a level that was really, really good just from being in Mexico. So when I first got to go to Japan, people thought I was like, how many years have you been living here?
Amazing. I love this. Right? This is so inspiring. I love this.
And I did it all through the internet way before YouTube was even a thing. But I found role models on the internet that were already having a result that I wanted. And I started modeling, imitating what they were doing because they were giving their advice on the internet. And it just allowed me to see new distinctions of how to tackle the language, you know?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, totally. And I mean, I love Japanese. I studied it in uni, but not for a long time enough to say I speak actually Japanese. But definitely it is something that I would love to resume at some point because Japanese is like super special for me.
Wow. I'll get into that some other time.
So I'm reading. So I've been listening about your personality speaking other languages is different. Oh my gosh, I love this. Yes, this is so true. Even I feel like this sometimes. Is there some scientific evidence for that? I wonder about it. This is such a great question. Thank you for this question. You know, I have never thought about it actually. Like if there is a scientific evidence for that. I don't know. I
can come up with an answer for myself. It's not a scientific answer. It's just an experiential answer. But when we grow up, let's say with our native languages, let's say it's Russian or Ukrainian or Italian for you, right? For me, it's English or Spanish. When you're using that language, let's say you're accessing certain parts of the brain and you're making certain connections, certain sounds, certain images that are related to your culture. So that's one chunk of information that you have right there. When you start learning a new language, it's like you're getting different sensory information, different connections, and you're trying to put them together, but they're in their own little world, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So you're in different states when you speak like your native language, you're in different states, mental states when you're in another language. So it's only natural that you're going to sort of change a little bit.
And that's interesting because, like, while you started speaking, I had come up with an answer in my head. Like, what is...
Go for it. Perfect.
Because it is a little bit similar to what you have said. So I have thought that, from my experience, you know, maybe for different people, it's different. So let us know if for you, people who speak other languages, if it feels different for you and how it feels. But as you said, you know, when you learn a new language, you learn a new world, a new set of behaviors and thoughts and things, you know, because if I'm talking about myself, so like Eastern European culture is pretty, you know, they're not, I mean, they might look angry or sad or grumpy or something. So, you know, when an Eastern European,
you're direct, right?
They speak like this. There's no emotions, no emotions in your face, because if you smile too much, there's something wrong with you.
I am so wrong.
Wait. But of course, you know, there is, I mean, for everything, there is an explanation, right? And like, if we look into the story, I mean, into the history of those countries, people have been through a lot of bad stuff, you know? So, I mean, there are reasons why people are like this.
Yeah, but, empathy.
You know, like when I think, but like when I speak Russian or Ukrainian, or when I go back to Ukraine and Russia, it's like I become that person because I know that this is how I am when I'm here. This is how people are, you know? And so like, if I want to feel part of this community, this is the way I need to be. But it's not about faking, guys. It's not like I fake to be this person. I just know that this is the way they are, okay? Then when I moved to Italy, right? And Italians are like super cheerful and smiley and just, they've got like this high energy and stuff. And this is where I learned to be like this as well. But again, not because I wanted to pretend to be this person, but because like I absorbed these values, like this lifestyle, this way of being, right? And in general, in Europe, people are more cheerful and stuff. Again, it depends on where, what part of Europe are you in, right? Because like the southern Europe is like, yeah, woo, festa and so on, and like northern part of Italy, like British culture, or like even I don't know, Sweden, Norway and so on, they're more like, you know, like serious. And so getting back on point, I believe that the reason why we feel like we are a different person when we speak different languages is because we like adapt these different behaviors to feel connected to feel part of that group, of that community, if that makes sense. That's how I see it.
Yeah, absolutely. You get triggered, your brain gets triggered into going into certain patterns of behaving and speaking and being. So yeah, if you're at a party, like let's say you're at a ball or a recital, everyone's quiet and you're the only one going, you're going to stand out too much. So you're going to break rapport with everyone there. You're not reading the in Japanese, they call this reading the air, reading what the social cues are in the environment. How are you supposed to be at that moment? So your brain adapts, you know, I got to be chill here. Right. But if you're at Carnaval in Rio de Janeiro, right? And everybody's partying and you're like, what's wrong with it? You know what? You're not enjoying this moment. So it's always, your brain is always adapting to the situation. And I think that happens with languages as well.
Yeah. We've got like, people are interacting so much on this live.
Yeah.
That's through your questions, guys.
Oh my God.
So new culture, you spend more time with different people, in my case Russian people, welcome, maybe you get similar to them. I don't know. Yes, I mean, that's what we were saying, you know, but it's because you want to feel part of that community, you want to feel part of that group of people you're hanging out with, so you consciously or unconsciously kind of borrow, you kind of adapt these behaviors you see in these people. You maybe adapt their intonation, tone of voice, expressions, even mimics, you know, like face expressions as well. If you realize it, or even if you don't realize it, and that's why it feels like you are a different person. But this is such a great question. Thank you for asking this question.
And here's the thing with connected with NLP. The way you move your body is going to affect the way that you feel. So if you're like this, you're not going to create a lot of energy. You're just chill. You're not moving your body too much. If you move around a lot, your breathing changes, the way that you talk, the rhythm, the pace changes. So all of that affects how people are going to perceive you, because it's all based on how your physiology is affecting your internal mental state at that moment. And language is immediately does that for us.
Yes. Mind and body are parts of the same system.
Yeah.
What about, what are our favorite languages and why?
Awesome. Yeah. Okay, I'll go into mine. So my favorite language is Japanese, number one. That's my number one. I mean, my wife is Japanese, right? But it's the language that showed me the most different world. It was the most, the language that changed me at my core, that really pushed me and motivated me to want to be a better person, to want to help others, because that's part of like my personal story. You know, I grew up in Mexico with a single mom. She did her best to raise us. So even though she did her best, I was still full of, you know, internal fears, internal traumas, so many things that I couldn't receive when I was little. So when I started on my journey with Japanese, it was like a journey to find myself.
Wow. This is so powerful. I've got like goosebumps when you
say that. I get goosebumps thinking about it too, right? So I went into new worlds. I achieved things that, you know, maybe people around me like, oh, he's a weird guy that's studying Japanese. But through my own journey at that moment, I was going through an internal, what do you call it, transformation, because the language was my vehicle, but I was actually going through a lot of internal like improvement. That's how I got into the self-improvement world as well. I went into a culture that's totally different from our Western culture, and that allowed me to pick up completely new values, you know, that we have here in the Western world. So yeah, that was the one that changed me the most. My next one, and I'm using it right now to work with amazing people, is Portuguese. I just actually started learning this language. At the beginning, I wasn't interested in it because it's very close to Spanish. So my reason, my why, was very little. But now it's like I work in Portuguese. I have a team that we create content together in Portuguese. We do lives in Portuguese. The culture just complements my Latin culture so much that it's like, it just feels like a perfect glove that fits my hand, you know? Yep. It's like,
and oh, I love it.
Like Italians, they are so bright. They're so fun. And I'm really impressed at the level of diligence that Brazilians have towards their work. Like, I thought it was just all party. No, man, these guys know how to work. Like smart, you know, I've met so many amazing smart people from Brazil, and we're working together while having a party at the same time. How about you? What are your favorite languages?
But like, I've got a question about Japanese. Like you said that it changed you at the core, and like it got you into self-development and stuff. Like was it the language itself, because it was challenging and so different from the Western culture and world and stuff, or was there something specific you got into when you were learning Japanese, like, I don't know, Japanese philosophy or religions or just the way they see the world and stuff? Because I know that, I mean, I studied it a little bit, and I know that many Asian cultures, they have like a super different view of the world, of how they view the world, how they see people, how they interact with people, how they see nature and connection and all the things. It's so different from the Western world. So like, what was it for you exactly? If you want to share.
Yeah, absolutely. So Japan is very different. You know, their main religions are Buddhism and Shintoism. Buddhism, I haven't studied it directly, but you pick up chunks here and there. It's all about like your connection with your mind, you know, how to disconnect from worldly desires and all that cool stuff. But for me, it's just really practical. You know, it's how to calm your mind and how to just be present. So I'm always like everywhere, you know, I'm like an ocean that's all going crazy all the time. Yeah. But when you learn those concepts, you learn to like be more here, more chill, more enjoy your experience. So that's one of the cool things that I picked up from Japanese culture. And it's just so embedded into their culture that you go there, everything is so clean. Everything, they're pretty chill, they're pretty calm, you know, they respect each other. And I think it comes from a lot of from that programming that those religions have given them, you know. So I was exposed to all of that. Their work culture is like brutal if you pick the wrong company to go to. But at the same time, they're just so committed to their work that sometimes that's what they put above everything else. You know, there's a lot of cases where people just work too much, work themselves into death.
Absolutely. But there is a name for it. I can't remember the name. It was something with hero or something, was it?
Like yeah, karoshi. Karoshi. Karo means too much.
Yep,
too much. Yep, too much work. And shi means death. So karoshi. Yes. Yeah. But at the same time, it's working. It's so embedded into their culture that sometimes some people, all that their lives is work. But when you really get to know them and you're able to jump past the persona and you can really get understand how they work and how they think, it's like the person that was like this all the time is laughing and you know, and is enjoying themselves so much. But physiologically, it's on a more subtle level. I mean, they're having the blast, their brain is getting full of dopamine, but right here they're like,
yes. Oh, I love this. Yes. So my favorite language, English has been my favorite language forever. Like since I remember English, since I started basically. And I just love it. I just love hearing English, talking to English speakers, speaking English, reading. I mean, it kind of became I wanted to say third, but it's actually fourth. Like English is my fourth language.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because it was Ukrainian first,
for
right?
Me, like first it's like Russian and then Ukrainian and then Italian and then English. So English is like the fourth language for me.
Wow. At what age did you start studying it? And what was like the thing that got you into it?
English?
Yeah.
I don't know. I just love the way it sounds. I love the pronunciation and I don't know. I just love it. You know,
I love your British accent, by the way, your English accent.
I think it got more Kiwi accent since I'm
here. Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, I moved the table. Sorry. And yeah, for sure. And I can hear it as well. Like, I mean, yeah. And the Kiwi slang is funny. I'm wondering if I will pick some Australian when I will go and hang out in Australia for a couple of weeks in February.
Yeah, I might. I do might.
But yeah. And I mean, I don't know. And I also love Spanish. I mean, I love Italian as well. I love Spanish. I love how it sounds. I just love it. Like even when I go to these tango classes and I hear this guy speaking Spanish, I'm like, I'm feeling so great. It's like, you know, like when you're really craving to hear that special song because that song makes you feel good or something. It's like for me, sometimes it's hearing that language. Like it can be
any
language. And I'm like, don't do nothing, just talk. And I'm like, yes, oh, this feels so good.
ASMR for Elena in Spanish.
And I also love Japanese, but not only the language, but Japanese is the whole concept, which is the mentality, the culture, history. people, traditions and stuff. I have never been to Japan myself yet, but I'd really love to. And yeah, so I mean, I just love all the languages.
Wow. What's your favorite Spanish song? Do you have one?
The one song that comes to my mind is I love South American songs. So okay. Like reggaeton, salsa, bachata and stuff.
Reggaetonera. Daddy Yankee.
But the song that comes to my mind is Sueña. And I can't, it's a pretty old song. It's, I don't know, like I was like 16 when I heard this song for the first time. It's called Sueña, and I can't remember the name of the guy. It's like Gerardo something, May something. I can link it to you if you want later.
Okay, yeah absolutely.
I just love it. It's just, you know, one of those songs that no matter what happens, you listen to this song and you feel better.
Oh,
you feel
it's your anchor.
You feel like there is someone for you, you know, you're supported, you're loved and stuff. I don't know, it gives me this feeling of, yeah, being connected.
You got a lot of good feelings conditioned to that song then, you know, it's your anchor that helps you go back to those feelings that are connected to your values, and it just puts you in that right spot, huh?
Yeah. And also, like, in the end, it says something like, if you see, it's been a while since I listened to this one, but in the end, it says something like, you know, even if you fall down like 6 times, you just get up, you know?
Yeah.
You get up for the 7th time and you keep going.
Yeah.
I love it. Yeah.
I read this amazing quote that it says that words are the most powerful drug available to the human mind.
What is it?
Words.
Yes.
Yeah. And it just, boom, it clicked for me, because words in a song linked to music, to rhythm, it's an instant way of conditioning us to feel certain emotions. So that one, you heard it when you were 16. They say that up until 18 is when we make the strongest linkages to things. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's based on data or something, but that's when things impress us the most, up to level 18. And then from there, it sort of starts dwindling down. But if you heard that while you were 16, I mean, it must have caused a deep impact on you, right?
Yes. Yeah. And I mean, I just love this life. I love how we go like back and forth to science and NLP and languages. But yes. Okay, guys, a little spoiler. There will be more on NLP and stuff. We will talk about it in a little bit. I just wanted to read this other comment. I do love Russian and I'm putting hard effort on it, but Japanese changes you inside. Yeah. There is something different on this Yazyk language. Yeah.
Yeah, he speaks Russian. This guy is amazingly intelligent. He speaks Japanese, Russian. He's a great guy.
Hello, then another polyglot here as well.
He is. Hola, otaku. Yeah.
And shall we share some stories? Do you have like some funny,
crazy stories involving language? Oh my god,
languages?
I got too like many.
To me, most of the times, like even yesterday, I was at a cafe.
Okay.
And basically, there were two guys speaking Italian, and at some point, one said, I'm wondering what languages this lady speaks, if she's understanding us. And I'm like, I speak all the languages. And then I replied in Italian. And he was like, oh, okay, hello. Because I don't look Italian, you know, like I'm, you know, my skin is pale and I'm blonde and stuff. I don't look Italian, but I do speak Italian. So people don't expect me to speak Italian either. Or like Spanish. So for sure, for me, like the funny story that happens all the time is that people just don't think about me speaking many languages.
Your secret code. I understand you people.
Yeah. Do people tell you, like, when you say that you speak so many languages, do people tell you, oh, so you're a spy? And I'm like, yes.
I've never gotten that one. No.
This is something that people tell me all the time. all the time. Like when I say, yeah, speak 7 languages. Oh, are you a spy? I'm like, yes, I am a spy.
Yes, I am. I tapped your house.
You know, I'm undercover. I can't really talk much about it.
I'm under my covers, you know, when I get scared.
What are you, some of your stories?
I got too many, but one that really pops to my head is just, it's related to Japanese. I was in Japan. I was still naive. I was still just learning to be more expressive. I was really shy. I couldn't speak very well with women from the opposite sex, for example. So I was in class and there was this girl that I thought was really cute and she was sitting next to me. And it was sort of awkward when I talked with her because I could speak the language. I was relatively fluent, but culture-wise, I still did not understand the culture. So a lot of the stuff that I generally said was very awkward, right? So she's sitting next to me and I'm trying to use sarcasm with her, which is something that Japanese don't use in the same way that we do. We say it, oh, so now you're going to go and do that, huh? It's like in the tone and in the words. But with them, it's a little bit different type of sarcasm. So she was wearing these clothes and she took her sweater off. And she looked really, really, whoa, like, wow, like really, really, really attractive. And so I said to her, oh, trying to be sexy, huh? But in Japanese. And she was just like, it's like, what's this guy saying? You know, I felt so awkward at that moment.
Oh my God.
I was like, oh my God, no, no. We say in Spanish, please, Earth, please swallow me right now. I want to disappear from here now, you know? So even though you can speak a language, it doesn't mean that sometimes you're going to understand the culture, because that's the other 80% too. Like, the language is amazing put in the door, but then it's understanding jokes, it's understanding the culture, the social references. And that is another part that once you understand those and you put them together, it's like, whoa, who are you? Right. So that's one of my embarrassing, crazy stories related to Japanese.
Yep. Because with Japanese, especially, you really need to be careful, like how you say things. Like, I was surprised when our Japanese teacher told us that, you know, in Japanese, they don't really have offensive words. There is only like baka, which is like the worst. But you can really offend someone by using the wrong verb, because they are very like, what's the word? The hierarchy thing.
Hierarchy. Mm-hmm.
So if you use the wrong verb, you know, you can really offend someone. So, you know, if you're using the verb that you're using with your friend, with your boss, it will be like, whoa, man. It's like super, so different. Japanese, isn't it?
Yeah, in Japanese, they don't have colorful array of words to insult people. They do. There's a lot more. Like, if you see the mafia talking, I mean, they know how to insult people, right? But it's not as colorful as, I don't know, English, as Spanish, as Korean, as Chinese. I mean, the Chinese will find 100 ways of offending your mom, you know. Mexicans will find it too. But in Japan, they do insult it, like you said, with the verb or with the tone of their voice, you know, with the way that look at you, with the way that they just don't even pay attention to you. It's more like nonverbal communication, and that can offend you too. Yeah.
Yep. Exactly. Yes. Yes, that's so true. I was just sorting out some tech stuff.
Yeah, no worries.
What about, by the way, guys, if you have some funny stories you have experienced yourself,
share us. We'll share it with everyone.
We'd love to hear your stories, you know, and like, so I believe that any language learner is brave and it's a courageous person, because, you know, it's really not easy to be in this vulnerable stage where you're not really sure about what you're saying, you know, but you still do it, you still go for it. So, you know, and it's totally fine when we have these embarrassing situations, you know, but just keep in mind that you are already brave that you're doing this. you know, not everyone can do something like this. So guys, I'm super proud of you, everyone who's learning and speaking other languages.
Or those that are wanting to, right? I think that most people don't have the strategies, so they label themselves like, oh, I can't do it. Oh, that's not for me. If you have the want, the strategies are all there. It's just finding them. It's reprogramming your mind to see new possibilities and start taking small action. And then it's like, oh my God, you do a breakthrough in when you thought that you could do. And that just, even just through language, if you get really decent, that'll give you confidence and it'll sink into all other parts of your life, you know?
Exactly. Yes.